Hey guys, it's Nick and Kiernan here from the Pokemon Troupe, and we actually have a really awesome video for you guys. This will be a part of our Road to World segment, as it is a tournament report for the World Championships, which Kiernan competed in, and the Boston Open. So let's just get right into it. Kiernan, do you want to talk a little bit about your World's experience first?
All right, well, my World's experience is pretty bad. At around 2 a.m. Thursday night, I decided that Flareon was the play for Worlds because there wasn't much Toad Gar being played. It was all Toad Bats, and you can tech out against any Toad that doesn't play Bats. Like, you just play Training Center, Ninetales, you just have a field day. You just beat Toads. Except I had a problem with my Flareons were sort of warped because they're foil. I try to play with all foil cards. But the Plasma Freeze set, in particular, has really bad warping, which would cause them to clump together.
Oh, okay.
So, in the three rounds, I ended up dropping, but in two of the three rounds, I started with four Flareons in my opening hand the first game. And then I don't think there was ever an opening hand where I didn't have at least two Flareons in it. It was awful. And I played against stuff that should win, too. Like, I played against Primal Groudon round one, which she ended up forcing the tie. I wasn't drawing what I needed. He was able to just load four Robo-subs out. They called time, and, there's just nothing I could do. And then round two, I played against Hippos, against the kid who he took ninth place at Nationals this year.
Okay.
He was pretty okay. He played Hippos, and I could never draw my Muscle Band. I played a single Muscle Band for Hippos. I played one Bangle, one Muscle Band.
Oh, yeah.
And I could never get to my Muscle Band despite burning through my deck, completely. And so eventually that came down to a tie. And then my third round, I played against Hippos again. And game one, I couldn't draw anything. I ended up just scooping that game. And then game two, I started Lone Eevee.
Oh, my gosh.
And then I had to draw Pass. And so he had a Hippopotas, or however you say it. And for those of you who don't know, it's first attack for a DC, it does 20. So he drops a DC, drops the Muscle Band, and that was it. And right after that, I just dropped, and I went and won a couple King of the Hills. But the next day for the Boston Open, I got really into it, and I looked in, I watched the stream from Friday, I rewatched it, saw what was popular, what was being played, and a deck that I was really liking was Night March, so eventually I decided that Night March would be a great play. And ended up, I took top 16 at it. For whatever reason, there's a top 16 cut. And yeah, I lost my top 16 match to a huge Luxac, which I'll explain later. But for now, let's get right into my list.
I just want to go through your deck.
Alright, so obviously I play the 4-4-4 Night Marchers. Can't play this deck without them. That's kind of how you make the deck work.
I mean, I don't know. Sometimes I can't find room for the fourth Lampent.
Oh, God. You're doing something seriously wrong.
No, I'm kidding. But yeah.
But for those of you who don't know, the deck basically revolves around getting Pokemon with Night March in the discard pile because...
with the Night March attack.
Mm-hmm. So. Yeah. Each Pokemon Night March does 20 times the amount of Pokemon that have the Night March attack in your discard pile. So, you get 9 into your discard pile, and you're doing 180 damage, and it's really easy to hit really high caps. It's an incredibly strong deck, especially with all the stuff that's weak to Lightning floating around. So, yeah. Pretty much just Mega Ray, but...
Mega Ray for now, yeah.
Yeah, but, I mean, Lugia next format, it's going to be... this deck is going to continue to see play, maybe even with the loss of Mew. I don't know. We'll see.
Yeah. Okay, so just get right into the other stuff.
Mm-hmm. I play two Mews, copy Night Marchers attacks, because the Night Marchers always get O-Code, and this is how you win the Toad matchup. Lots of people think Toad is an auto-loss for Night March, but it really isn't. All you have to do is go second, copy their Quaking Punch, get a Muscle Band, and Quaking Punch them before they Quaking Punch you. Because what happens then is you're doing 50 damage to them while you're doing 30. So you can knock them out before they can knock you out with Mew. And then, so the idea is to Quaking Punch their Toad for three turns in a row so that they're behind on getting their setup going. And after that, you sky return. You reset your meal. So you give them a turn of items. That's inevitable. But then after that, all you have to do is just begin the Quaking Punch train again. Or alternatively, if you can get out two Mews, you can circulate between the two of them, knock out two Toads, and then once you have to, you can sky return. But by the late game, you may not even need to sky return because you can just load up a Joltik and just finish the game with Night March.
So Mew, definitely a very strong component to the deck. Definitely going to be missed in the rotation.
Oh yeah, definitely. I feel like it can live without it though, because Toad's not going to be near as big without Laser after the rotation. And Mew's what makes your Toad matchup. You cannot beat Toad without Mew.
Mm-hmm.
Play two Shaymin and one Jirachi. Lots of people play three Shaymin, no Jirachi. I just think Jirachi, whether playing Archie's Empoleon or not, which I am, and I'll explain that in a couple minutes here, a couple seconds, whatever. I just think Jirachi's such a great card. I don't see why it's not played in everything. It's such a great consistency card. And in this deck where you play eight supporters, the version without Archie, you play seven supporters. It's just great to be able to get whatever supporter you need. And then Shaymin, everything plays Shaymin. You want to draw cards. Drawing cards is fun.
And the Jirachi is really good for getting like that clutch Lysander whenever need that, if it's still in deck, of course.
Oh yeah, it's. We play one Empoleon. It's useful. It's mainly for the Lando Bats matchup because Landorus Bats is a very popular deck in the Boston Open for seniors due to Night March, seeing a lot of play. But it's useful against lots of other matchups. It's useful against Toad, being able to discard Night Marchers with Diving Draw under item lock. And it's got a nice attack. It comes into play in the mirror when you don't want to be
using Night March.
Yeah, when you don't want to be losing DCs to using Night March. It's really great in the mirror. It's a really great card. And it's a card that I'm definitely going to miss having it in Night March.
Mm-hmm. How often did you ever go for the T1 Archie's Empoleon?
I did in the Night March mirror, but every other time I played against Lando Bats, which I'll go into more detail when I actually go over my rounds. But when I played Lando Bats, game one, I had my Archie prize along with my Mr. Mime. Game two, I had my Empoleon prize. And game three, I just could never get the combination to work. But I still managed to take that series 2-1 just because of the sheer speed and power of Night March.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'd regularly get a Night March off for 180 turn 1. That's not hard to do at all.
Okay.
Next up, Mr. Mime is our last Pokemon because, once again, Landorus Bats is popular. It also helps against Manectric Water, which saw quite a bit of play. You can protect yourself from Overruns and Frostbeer. And I'm trying to think, are there any other relevant Snipe Pokemon besides Landorus, Kyurem, and Manectric?
Well, I guess Darkrai EX, but I don't think Dark Pokemon got really any play at Worlds.
I only got Darkrai once.
You got Darkrai once?
I got Darkrai once.
Dang.
And that was in the side event. It was an expanded side event. I just played this, you know, I played level balls and whatnot. Had it all worked out for expanded. It was a neat play. But, oh yeah, and I played over Empoleon, I played Archeops, but I got Darkrai. I got Night Spirit.
Aww.
I ended up taking the match. I had no idea what I was playing against, because he started Darkrai, and he was playing three Darkrai, two Yveltal. It was a Darkrai-focused deck because of all the Night March. So he got off the turn one Night Spirit, and I'm like, what am I dealing with? And so I didn't bench any more Joltik, so I put down Mr. Mime, and I managed to take the series, but
nice.
It was a big surprise, and he ended up doing fairly well.
Nice.
Next up, we're going to be moving on to trainers. So starting with items, A-Spec of choice is obviously Computer Search. That's easily the best A-Spec right now.
Especially in Night March.
Oh, yeah. And a deck that plays Archie's Ace in the Hole, you need to be able to search for the last card that you need to complete the combo. You need to be able to discard cards. The biggest part about Archie's Ace in the Hole is being able to discard cards and get your hand down to that one, the Archie. For my other items, I played four Ultra Ball and four BS Seeker.
Pretty standard.
We should be playing that in every deck. Ultra Ball's really nice because you want to discard Night Marchers. Even in Expanded, I'd still play four, maybe two Level Ball. And then VS Eager, you only play eight supporters. I feel like four is necessary.
Yeah, especially with such a low supporter count.
Oh yeah, definitely. I play two trainers now and two acro bike. This was, I got a lot of criticism for this because they're the people who say you need to play four acro bike because you need to discard night marchers, or you need to play four trainers mill because you need to be able to fail the search if it's the last card in your hand for Archie. But like, well, that's true for other stuff. You want to play, it's really clear cut for Flareon. You know, you want to be able to discard night marchers with acro bike, and you want to be able to fail the search with Archie. So you either play one or the other and play on both. This, it's not that clear cut, because when you want to play the Archie, you've got your trainer's mail, and it's also great for the beginning of the game, but it only gets you so far, because you can't trainer's mail for double colorless energy.
You can
with acro bike, and that's huge, because you need to, especially in the mirror match, if you aren't getting a double colorless down, if you aren't night marching every single turn, you lose. That's what it comes down to, because then they get ahead of the price trade. And they're both really nice cards. And there's never a time where I couldn't get off a night march solely because I had an acro bike in hand. Because lots of the stuff you get is, you can pitch it. It's pitchable. Next up, I play four Battle Compressor, because what night march deck doesn't? It's an amazing card. And once again, a big part of why Flareon has to play Acro Bike is four Battle Compressor. They need 16 in the discard to get knockouts, but Night March, you only need
nine.
You need nine, yeah.
Or maybe like eight with a muscle band or something.
Well, usually what I tend to do, like my fun play for turn one was I'd Battle Compressor away. Even if I had nine Pokemon that I could pitch, I'd Battle Compressor away eight Pokemon, and my first Night March would be done with a Night March Pokemon, not Mew, with a Muscle Band. And then once they knock out that Night March Pokemon, that's your ninth.
Yeah, there.
And
yeah.
So you don't have to overextend your resources to get knockouts.
Yeah, definitely a smart play.
It's one of those little intricacies that puts you ahead of the other Night March players, which there are definitely a lot. The top 16 was actually, there were nine night marches.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it was insane. There are nine night marches, one Toad Shaman.
Oh gosh.
One Megumanitric Water, which I ended up losing to. And then the rest was Primal Groudon. Oh, and there's a Bunnelby Slurpuff.
Oh boy.
Which everyone was scared of. And all the night marchers, he was just taking down night marchers throughout the tournament. But I didn't understand why everyone was losing to him, because apparently people didn't realize that all you had to do was copy his burrow and just discard his cards. Like, he plays Slurpuff. He's going to be drawing cards faster than you. So and he played compressors. He played crushing hammers. He was burning through his deck. And I actually think he just played four Juniper and two Lysander as his supporters. So, I mean, like, all you have to do is just burrow, do what he's doing faster than him, and you can kill his Bunnelbees. Once you have a Mew ready to burrow, it's done. That's over. Because his deck, he doesn't play laser. He doesn't play anything to do damage. He discards cards. Fortress Shovel, you know, all that. And then, like, he's never going to knock out. Once you've got a Pokemon ready to burrow, you're going to be burrowing for the rest of the game.
Mm-hmm.
So, next up we've got One Town Map. So many people play Night March without it, and I can't stress this enough. It's one of the best cards in Night March. So many people play it without it, and you know, you don't feel like you need it. But once you play it, you cannot play without it. It's such a strong card.
Just so that you can get the certain Night March Pokemon when they're prized is a big deal.
I can't remember who I was playing. It might have been Jason Kozinski, but I was playing him just for fun. And I had, like, I used Town Map. I had two Joltix prized. I ended up winning the game, but had I not known I had those two Joltix, like, had I not been able to see where they were in my prices, I might not have drawn them, and I might not have won the game because of it. Next up for tools, we play two Muscle Band and two Floatstone. Muscle Band is kind of a weird card. Lots of people say you should play one Muscle Band and one Silver Bangle, but I never missed not having Silver Bangle in my deck. Because the only deck where I felt like I needed it against was actually played against Dragon Mega Rayquaza in my win-in. And, but I was still able to win just because, you know, I win the prize trade. You really don't need Bangle because, I mean, the only time it hurts your math is when you play against something like Mega Rayquaza that has 230 HP, but after that resistance, because of his ability, he effectively has 250. And so, with that, you need to have 11 Night Marchers and a Bangle in your discard pile. But that's, you're overextending your resources a ton by doing that. And I really feel like the better thing to do is to Lysander around the Mega Rayquaza, or just 2-co it. Like, you're in no rush. You don't need to Oko the Mega Rayquaza. Because if they can't get that Shrine of Memories out, then they're having to do 300 damage and discarding energies every time they kill a Night Marcher. And then lastly, Floatstone. Lots of people play, maybe a Switch, maybe an Escape Rope, but I love Floatstone on this deck. You drop it, it's a great card to drop for drawing with Shamans, you don't have to use it early. It's a lot better so that you don't have to switch into an undesired Pokemon when you're just trying to get off the Archie's Ace in the Hole. And it's just great having something with Free Retreat after something gets knocked out.
I like that.
Something gets knocked out, you can just promote something with Floatstone and just have Free Retreat, which is really nice. And it's one of the most overlooked cards in the deck, and I think it's a great card. Next up, moving on with supporters, we have 4 Professor Juniper, 1N. 4 Professor Juniper is standard. 1N, I like it in this, just because it's a faster deck. It's an Archie deck, and it's just, you're taking prizes really fast, and you really just need one shuffle draw supporter. If I wasn't discarding so much stuff, I probably would consider even playing Colress over the end. But for now, I really like having 1N, and it was useful when I was behind in the game. Night March Mirror, it's really useful. 1 Archie's Ace in the Hole to get out Empoleon. And another often overlooked thing with Empoleon is that you can afford to go down to 1 prize. Lots of people will avoid playing the 7 prize game because of being end to 1. But an end to 1, as long as you've got an Empoleon in play, an end to 1 is an end to 4. Because you've got your end to 1, you've got that one card, you draw for your turn, and then you can pitch something to draw 2 with Diving Draw. And so, and you just have access to a lot more cards. So Empoleon's just great for this deck in general. Mm-hmm. And then lastly, I play 2 Lysander because if you want to be able to Lysander, get the Okos that you can get. If they've got a Mega or something up that you can't knock out, you want to be able to Lysander around and get something that you can knock out. Because one of the biggest things with Night March is, there's always the temptation to start. You don't want to have to kill the Shaman. You want to start working with the thing that's doing all the damage. But one of the biggest parts about Night March, one of the biggest ways you win, is by constantly taking knockouts on 2 prize Pokemon. And with 2 Lysander, it's fairly easy to do. You've got 6 outs to Lysander. If I could fit in a third, I would definitely play a third. Not only because of that, like I just said, but Donphan was also popular. And having 3 Lysander seals the Donphan matchup for you. For our stadiums, we play 4 Dimension Valley. Its effect, if you want to zoom in, its effect is that each psychic Pokemon attacks for 1 colorless energy less. And
it's pretty standard in this deck, but
yeah. But if you look at Mew, it's a psychic Pokemon, so you can use Night March for 1 energy if you use it on Joltik. Lots of people were telling me I need to up my energy count to deal with Aegislash, but when you play Mew, you don't have to. Because you can use Night March for 1 energy fairly easily. And I played against Metal, and I was able to just destroy them because I could beat their Aegislash. And then they couldn't do anything with Cobalion because I'd have water energy on my Mew. And there's nothing they could do about it. My energy count is 3 water, 4 double colorless. It's pretty standard. Lots of lists that even don't play Empoleon for whatever reason just default to the water. I mean, if I wasn't playing it, I'd default to the lightning, but that's just me. Because there's actually, if anyone watched the stream, there was a play where a Joltik knocked out another Joltik in the mirror by muscle banding and using Gnaw for 10. And then that, I'm pretty sure that's what sealed the game too. So it's all you really need. Everything's a cheap attacker. And you can realistically get off 7 Night Marches with this energy lineup. It's not very tough to do. I've never played a game where I was like, oh, if I just played one more energy, then I could finish the game.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's that fast of a deck, you don't need to. So, going into my rounds, at the Boston Open, I started off the day playing against a Mega Rayquaza deck, Metal Rayquaza. So that was fairly straightforward. He had an Aegislash I had to get around, but that wasn't terrible. It's a little tougher to get around Aegislash in Metal Rayquaza than straight metal, just because you want to be powering up those Joltics to take one-hit knockouts on the Rayquazas, but I was able to take the game 2-0. And then round two, actually played against another Metal Rayquaza.
Oh boy.
Which went the exact same way, except her list played one Aegislash. It only played one Aegislash.
Oh, so that was pretty easy.
And she prized it both games, so...
Oh my goodness.
That wasn't even a challenge for me. The biggest obstacle I had was... I ran out of Joltics in the second game because she put up a Heatran and I had to kill the Heatran with my Joltik because I didn't have the Lysander, and then she knocked out the Joltik, but I had a Pumpkaboo on the bench, and she didn't realize that after killing all four Joltiks that I had 11 Pokemon in my discard pile, so I sent up the Pumpkaboo and I just attached the double colorless and that was it.
Nice.
So round three, what did I play against round three? Was that the... I think that was the round I played against the Night March Mirror. It was incredibly back and forth. I ended up, ultimately, that was my one loss of the day, solely because in game three, I ended up prizing two double colorless.
Oh, yeah.
Along with my town map, so I couldn't root out those double colorless in my prizes. So he ended up taking the game. He also went on to make cut. It was a kid from Belgium, actually, which was pretty cool. So at that point I was 2-1. Next round I played against Metal. I played against a kid who top 32'd Worlds the past year, and I think he took 10th at Nationals this year as a junior. This was his first event as a senior because it was the new season, so you had to play in your new age division. So yeah, lots of my friends had to play as Masters. Yeah, he was playing Metal, and I just did what I did with Mew, and he played the game a little too aggressively, in my opinion. He was trying to get fast Slash Blast up, as opposed to putting up one prize Pokemon and just slowing down until he could actually take Okos with Slash Blast. So he would Slash Blast me for 60, and then I'd Night March, and then he'd send, you know, a Mew would go down here and there, but I was able to trade one Mew for two Aegislash, that ultimately put me ahead. And there's one time where I did actually, I used a Night March for 120. I wasn't able to get the knockout. And then the Aegislash Slash Blasted me for 60. So then I was able to attach the Muscle Band and actually use Sky Return for the knockout, because Aegislash is 170, which was huge. And that's what won me the game. And then round four, I played against Landorus Bats. The biggest reason I even play Archie's Ace in the Hole in this list. And game one, I prized the Archie and the Mr. Mime, but I was just able to outspeed her, load up Night Marchers. I didn't bench any Joltics because I didn't have Mr. Mime. And ended up, I took the series 6-1, I believe, or I took the game 6-1. Game two, I prized the Empoleon, and I just wasn't drawing what I needed. And eventually I was out of Dimension Valley, and I couldn't realistically finish the game. It was a close game. I was down to two prizes, and if I had a Dimension Valley or another energy, then I would have been able to seal the game. But I was out of both of those, so I just conceded to make time for game three. And then game three, I was able to get down the Mr. Mime. I had both the components to my Archie in deck. I never got the card combo I needed to get it off. And I never had too much trouble with it, too, just because I can Night March for big numbers, favoring Pumpkaboo. And then...
Because it does have resistance to fighting, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
Which can be really good against Landorus.
Yeah. Well, it ended up... I don't think it ever actually came into play. I feel like it did... Landorus did 50 once, but it was killed with a bat, so...
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I'd already had 20 on it, so that it didn't really come into play, but it was nice, because Landorus is also resistant to lightning. That's what people forget in that trade, so you need to have 10 Night Marchers in the discard, or 9 with a Muscle Band, that requires you to overextend your resources a lot. So, as long as you don't bench Joltics until you have to, it tends to work out in your favor. So then round six, what did I play against round six? Oh yeah, round six I played against Dragon Rayquaza. And this was the craziest match of all, just because I sat next to him, and he knew, like, Dragon Rayquaza has a terrible Night March matchup, and so the only way he knew he was going to win, he tried to rule slayer everything. He was trying to bring the judges into everything that could possibly happen, which I'll explain as we go into it. But the funniest thing was, as we started out, he goes, "Do you want an ID? I'm playing Don Fan." And, you know, I'd already seen him, and I said, "No, you're playing Dragon Rayquaza." And he goes, "No, I'm playing Don Fan. That was my opponent that was playing Dragon Rayquaza." And I'm like, "Do you know what I'm playing?" And he goes, "Yeah, Night March." And I go, "Well, I mean, if you're playing Don Fan, you'd rather play it out, so let's just play it out." And so then he starts High Dragon, and I go, "That's a really weird wall for Don Fan." And then he goes, "Calm down, it was just a joke." You know, I was creaming him. And then, like, I took a quick game one. Game two, I was sort of dead drawing. He got way ahead in the prize trade. And then, you know, at this point, he was just trying to waste time. So one time I acrobiked, and I had a VS Seeker and a Battle Compressor in hand. And so I put down Battle Compressor on top of the acrobike, like I meant to take Battle Compressor, and then I went to discard the other card. And then he called a judge over, because since I put down acrobike, or since I put down Battle Compressor, which, I mean, I was also using it, so it didn't matter whether I put it down, he was trying to tell the judge that that meant that I had to discard Battle Compressor. And so I got a warning for not doing it right. He got a warning for arguing with the judge. And then I ended up scooping that game because I just ran out of steam. And then game three, what happened was there's a Night March knockout on a Reshiram. And I had six Night Marches in the discard. But Reshiram has 130 HP. And, I mean, after the game, I thought I heard him telling his friend that he knew that it wasn't a knockout. He was just trying to keep it that way so that I'd get in trouble with the judge. But the judge came over, and, you know, we ended up both getting a prize loss, which was okay for me because I fly ahead in the prize trade. And so that meant that I was effectively taking two prizes on that Reshiram. And I was set up, I could take five prizes. I could knock out that Reshiram and kill two EXs, but I was not able to take six prizes. So solely because of that judge call, and us getting a double prize penalty, each of us did. We each got a prize penalty. I was able to take my last five prizes, but had that not happened, he would have been able to force the tie. So, and then my last round was against Night March, and I just ID'd.
Okay.
And then day two, I played against Mega Metric Articuno, which was a real interesting deck. The Articuno from Roaring Skies. The Articuno from Roaring Skies. And it's interesting. It helps Mega Metric's Night March matchup. It's got Delta Plus, which makes it so that if it knocks a Pokemon out, it takes another prize for it, like Lugia's Overflow. And so the first game I drew absolutely dead. Ended up scooping the game. And then the second game, I just destroyed him because I was just way faster. And I was able to Lysander out the Articunos before they could do any real damage. But then game three, it was super back and forth. We were just exchanging knockouts. And eventually what it came down to was he had two Water NGs in hand, and he showed me, because we were at the point of the game where he had his Shaman for four. If he drew the four cards he needed, he won. If he didn't draw all four of the cards, I won. And so he puts down the Shaman, and so he flips over his first card, Magmanetric Spirit Link. Okay, he needed that. Second card, Lysander. He needed that too. Third card, Magmanetric. At this point, I'm sort of freaking out. And I was like, he can't possibly draw the fourth card. He can't finish this combo off. And then he flips over the last card, and it's a Mega Turbo.
Oh my goodness.
And so he mega evolves into Magmanetric Mega Turbos because he already attached for the turn. And then he Lysanders out my Pumpkaboo and Turbo Bolts for game. And that was the end of my run. But I got 45 points, and I got this mat if you want to zoom out on it. And the interesting thing about this is it looks just like my world's mat, my competitor mat, except that it doesn't have the competitor sign on it. And there are only 64 of these in circulation because they only gave them to the top 32 Masters in the Boston Open, and then the top 16 juniors and seniors. So this mat, there are only 64 of these out there. So it's one of the things that I'm going to be selling. We may make a video about it. I don't know. Usually let Nick handle that. But make sure to leave us a comment if you're interested in it. We can work something out. And we also have all this stuff that we'll probably showcase in a full-on video at some point. This is all stuff for sale. A bunch of mats, some staff stuff, dice bags, deck boxes, hats, plushes. Yeah, we've got a whole lot of stuff, and we've got a whole lot of content for you coming up here. So make sure to stay tuned. This is Kieran and Nick with the Pokemon Troupe.
Hey, I wasn't done.
Oh, you're not done?
No, I wanted to ask you some questions. Let me talk a little bit. So, would you say there's anything that you would change about your Night March list that you used in the Boston Open?
I would say I probably wouldn't have played the Archie and Empoleon. Probably would have played two Revive instead.
Oh, yeah.
Mainly because, I mean, I never used it against the one Lander Spats I played, and there's no Toad there, except for the one Toad Shaman that somehow made cut, which was, it was super weird, but all the Toads got obliterated by Primal Groudon, but the Toad Shaman missed all of the Primal Groudon, ended up making cut at flight one, that was flight two, ended up making cut at first seed, that was fourth seed in flight two, but... Yeah, the only thing, I would have dropped those two and played two revives, because there are lots of times where, I mean, I had to drop a game. I mean, it ended up well, but there are a couple times where I had to drop a game just because I was out of Night Marchers, and I could have changed some 2-1s into 2-0s.
Oh, yeah.
But all in all, it went pretty well, and I feel like had my opponent not gotten that luck sack, all of the Night Marches were pretty poorly paired up. I mean, there's one, the Lander Spats list, I'm pretty sure it made cut, and I think one of the Night Marches played it. There's a Night March Mirror, since there are 9 of them, that's inevitable. There was one played Toad Shaman and got obliterated. One played the Bunnelby Slurpuff. I'm pretty sure 3 Night Marches made it through, because I know one Primal Groudon did win its game against Night March. So I feel like had I won that, I would have been pretty well prepared, just because I know how to play all these matchups that no one else knew how to play against. Because I was playing right next to the Toad Shaman Night March matchup, and what it came down to is that the kid playing Night March didn't know that you could just Quaking Punch. And so he lost that. But I feel like I had a good shot of winning had my opponent not gotten that Shaman. But I mean, it happens. I can't be mad about it, because I've gotten lucky too. I can't remember where it was, but there was a game where I needed a Dimension Valley for the game, and I got N-1. I didn't have the Empoleon out, so I drew my first card, and it was a Professor Juniper. And then I drew my second card, I drew for my turn, and it was a Dimension Valley.
Oh, wow.
So I got extremely lucky, so I can't blame him for getting lucky. It happens with Shaman.
Yeah. So I noticed that, like you said, you didn't play any revives in your deck. So I guess you said that didn't really come into play too much. It would have just helped you make sure you didn't drop a game.
Yeah.
But I feel like it's definitely necessary in XY on Night March.
Oh,
for
yeah,
sure. Just because,
the lack of Mew. But
the lack of Mew, for sure.
There wasn't ever a time where I felt like I really needed it. And the list was so space tight, I just couldn't find the space for it. And it just, the biggest thing I did with it was turn it with Battle Compressor into sort of an Ultra Ball. Able to Battle Compressor out Night Marchers and then revive one of them.
Oh, yeah.
So then you're effectively discarding 2 cards and getting 1.
Nice.
Except with 2 cards instead of 1 card. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I like it. It didn't warrant the space, in my opinion. And, I mean, it wouldn't have changed the tournament, in all honesty. Just because, my only losses were lack of energy or a lucky Shaman. It never came down to not having enough Night Marches to attack.
Yep.
So.
Well, congrats on making it to the World Championships. Hope for your best in the upcoming season. Hope you can make it there again. Hopefully we can make it out to San Francisco this year.
Yeah, we'll see you.
It'll be a lot of fun.
San Francisco.
Ooh. But yeah, That's pretty much it. Make sure to smash that like button and subscribe for some more awesome Pokemon content. We're going to have a lot of stuff coming to you guys soon. And that's about it. Anything you have to say, Kiernan?
Good luck to everyone to getting to San Francisco.
Yep. And
I see a bunch of you there.
And that's the Pokemon Troupe signing off.
Bye.
Pokemon Troupe out.